I'd like to start the public session. We have four speakers lined up tonight. Please step up to the mic, state your name and address. First is Ann Becker.
Good evening. My name is Ann Becker. I am the owner of Taste the World, Specialty Food and Coffee in Canal Commons at 193 West 1st Street. And I'm just here to speak on behalf of the Mugs and Motors Car Social that I've requested street closure with fee waiver the second and fourth Sundays of June, July, and August. And I just want to reiterate to everybody that this is a free public event. There's no fees, no charges for anybody to come to it with their vehicle or to come and enjoy walking the streets, enjoying the day, and looking at the vehicles, chatting with the owners, and listening to the music that is provided by business sponsorship. So this event does cost a fair amount to put on, and again, it is free to the public. It was suggested that perhaps I consider a different location or hiring an event planning company to run this event for us. I feel strongly that we do a very nice job, and the location that we have chosen and that we are continuing to request to have it in that same location is on West 1st Street in downtown Oswego, because part of the goal in setting this event up was to bring people downtown, get them used to coming downtown on a Sunday, keeping them coming downtown. And this event could also spark new events to come. I'd like to ask the city to just support this event, support it in voting yes tonight. I feel that this could just bring more events downtown, and I'd like the city to just keep considering standing behind the event planning companies, the individuals, anybody who has an interest in creating events for the public and for the community to help support Oswego. Thank you.
Thank you. Heath Jones.
My name is Heath Jones, 130 East 3rd Street. I want to kind of echo what Ms. Becker just said and encourage the council to look at supporting the event that she's brought forth for this evening. I'd also like to thank the mayor. We had a brief conversation earlier in the week, and I know that he's worked towards trying to find an alternative to having DPW paid overtime for delivering those road closures, the barricades, which I think is great. And I'd like to just say that oftentimes with some of the things that our event company and people like Ann have brought forth, that there's often other solutions. And if we work together and bring everybody together in the conversation, I think that we can find those without it costing either as much to the taxpayers or even anything, as I hope that we find this evening. The other thing that I'd like to say is that obviously this is a topic of conversation recent, and there are several events that have been brought forth, many from our event company in support of local nonprofits and some of the other community events that we run. And I think that if the council could look at something like almost a grant process before you go to budgets for this year, so that all of the events that are asking for waivers of any kind or support from the city in any way be delivered maybe a month before you guys go to budget hearings, so you could look at the applications individually and budget those for the year, that might be a better way of going about this. So you could basically say the city has X amount of money to put towards events and promoting our city, and we're willing to do this. And then you look at the applications that come forth, and you can, depending on the applications and the information that the planners can provide to you, determine which ones fit in to what your vision of growing our city is. I feel like that's a very positive way of going about this and setting some guidelines for people that are coming forth with ideas and projects to build the tourism and make this a place that people want to move to and live and raise children here. But that might be an easier way to go about that. I'd be happy to help with that process any way, shape, or form. So thank you, guys.
Thank you, Heath. Sue Matthews.
Hello, councilors and mayor. Since we have a lot of new faces this year, I thought I'd give you an update on our community garden. It's our fifth season, and the city had generously donated a previously useless strip of land that was an old railroad track, and we've used all sustainable resources in the community that we all have available for free to build a garden. We have very few rules. We have no GMOs, no chemicals, and none of the food that we grow is to be sold. And one thing we all have in common is we all eat. And it has grown. In our fifth season, we have on the east side between 60 and 70 individual and family plots. We also have 8 really large plots that are open to the public to work in and harvest from. One of those is run by Human Concerns, and they grow the food themselves from that plot, and it goes to Human Concerns, and our overflow also goes to Human Concerns. And when we have more than they can use, we also drop them off at the Salvation Army for their meals. And we really appreciate that there's a resolution tonight for us to get a little help with some of the labor over there, because we could do a lot more if we had more manual labor. But the other thing we did was 2 years ago, our non-GMO crops, we grow mostly heirlooms and some hybrids, but mostly heirlooms. You can reuse the seeds from the heirlooms, unlike GMOs. So we've established a seed library at the Oswego Public Library where people can go and get seeds to plant their gardens at home. The first year, I'm going to guesstimate we put about 1,000 packets of seeds out there. And I went over to check, and the only thing left was a few mustard seeds. So I'm sure they were well used. And so in relationship to another resolution you have up tonight, on the $12,000 you're transferring to spray our parks with herbicides, we would like to be specifically exempted from that resolution. We do not want any kind of chemicals sprayed in or near the community garden. And the community garden is officially a public city park. So we'd like to be exempted from that resolution. At the very least, we are asking to be exempted from that resolution. Further on that subject, I'm thinking the only reason you're even considering spraying toxic poisons in our public parks is that you're unaware of the facts. Just because the state licenses a company to spray toxic chemicals does not mean they're safe. There's been numerous studies done. There's numerous lawsuits in process. The World Health Organization has stated that Roundup is a probable carcinogen. California is getting ready to call it such. There's a lawsuit in France about it right now. Dozens of countries have outlawed the use of Roundup. And it's produced by Monsanto, who also produces GMO seeds. And I want you to be aware of the slippery slope you're on here. When they originally started using Roundup, they found that the weeds became resistant to it. So when you start spraying with it, the weeds become more resistant. So then they engineered a new GMO corn that was Roundup resistant, so they could spray more Roundup on the corn in order to kill the resistant weeds. Now, both the US Congress and the EPA says that these chemicals are in no way good for the health or safety of any living thing. They kill everything, including the microbiology of the soil. It's made to kill plants, but also funguses and molds that break down organic matter in the soil and make it available to plants are killed by these chemicals. So then they had to genetically engineer something for that. They ended up coming out with a new product that's a weed and feed, and it's used commonly on many lawns because since you've killed the plants that create nutrition, now they have to feed them with chemicals too. So it becomes a slippery slope. There's a long list of health problems associated with many of these chemicals. The CDC did a study of over 900 people randomly chosen. 100% of those people, they tested for 23 chemicals commonly used, herbicides, pesticides, insecticides. Of those over 900 people tested, 100% of them had at least 15 of the 23 chemicals they were testing in their blood and in their urine, and other tests have shown it's also in the milk of nursing mothers. They know that a lot of these chemicals cause neurotoxic damage, which children and pets are more susceptible to neurotoxic damage because their systems are developing. They also cause immune problems. Your gut bacteria are also plants. Without them, vitamin B isn't available for you to absorb. It also affects your immune system. Your immune system is educated by your gut bacteria. This is relatively a new find that the medical community is just starting to study. Just because the state licenses these companies to spray this stuff doesn't mean it's safe. Both Congress and the EPA agree it is not, it needs more testing. And so when I heard that you were allotting $12,000 to spray herbicides in all our public parks, I wasn't the only one that was shocked. I've received a lot of comments about it this week. And I can only figure that you aren't aware of the facts. This is not safe. It's not something we want in our parks. I was kind of wishing Mr. Emmons was here tonight because I know he sells organic diapers in his business, because people, most of the cotton now, 90% of the cotton is grown, it's genetically modified and sprayed with Roundup. People don't want it next to their baby's skin, whether they're wearing diapers or crawling on the grass in the park or over there for the great latch on. It's just not a good idea. Our $12,000 could be better spent. And I'm thinking that just to spray the dandelions in the cracks, it isn't worth endangering people. And we'd all like nice manicured parks, and maybe we can get some volunteers to pull some weeds, or in the garden, when we have really noxious stuff, we spray it with salt and vinegar and dish soap. And for most weeds, it works fine. And it's just a safer alternative. One of my friends said she'd volunteer to get a couple of goats and walk around the parks all year and let them eat the weeds. But I'm sure there's a better alternative, and I think our $12,000 could be better spent. I talked to Mike Smith about this before, several years ago, and he said we always use these things on a very limited basis. $12,000 worth of poison is not what I'd call a limited basis. I thank you and hope you consider what I have to say.
Thank you. Last speaker is Jean Mazzoli.
My name is Jean Mazzoli, and I'm here to try to raise money for the March of Dimes on April 30th. The March of Dimes is a special organization that tries to help make sure babies are born healthy. We hope to raise money by doing the March of Dimes so we can help more people and our community, and I would appreciate your support. Thank you.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to address the council? Mercedes?
I know. Good evening, council and Mayor Barlow. I'm here to address, unfortunately I was out of town for your council committee meeting, but I wanted to just discuss the event fees that were being bantered about. I wanted to say that virtually every day of my work life, I have to problem solve. There's always some kind of issue. How do I make it work with very little money or not enough volunteers or whatever? And somehow we make it happen. The goal is to make things work and to be the best event or program or project, whatever it can possibly be. And the best way to do that is to gather as much information as I can, to talk to people that are knowledgeable about whatever it is we're working on, and to not have a knee-jerk reaction on how to make it work. I proposed previously that standard forms be created for events that organizations, businesses, or individuals could plan could fill out, especially if they were planning to use public space, and that they would need to complete that, submit it to City Hall, and it would serve several purposes. First off, it would enhance the communication within City Hall and with the department heads, so that they would know what's going on in the community. You would know what's going on in the community. Sometimes there's events one side of the river and the other side doesn't know about it. I know that's true. Even I'm not an east side, west side person, but I do know that's a fact. The other things is it could be a way to link these events into our new website. Again, so we're enhancing communication to the public. They also could be utilized to track information. It could track the success of the events, the impact that it would have on the community, and this could be a variety of things. It could be reflected in the attendance figures, maybe sales tax revenue generated, maybe not, maybe just the intrinsic value and the quality of life that this event has in a community. It might be just a great community building activity. Mr. Emmons isn't here this evening, but he's already done quite a bit of research looking at various forms used by many other municipalities of similar size. We don't have to reinvent the wheel. The forms are out there. What I am asking is that, you know, you consider these events an investment in the city, in the residents of the city, and hold off charging event fees until further conversation and input can come from the public and maybe gathered through this process. This would make it a fair process, and also that this would be forthright and there wouldn't be any kind of favoritism for one event over another, one organization or business over another, and that we would really have just a forthright process that everyone would have a fair shot at. So thank you very much, and thank you for letting me speak.
Miles.
Thank you, Mayor. I know you want to get into your speech here, and I'll try and make it short, okay? But there's been a source told me, I like to use the word source, told me that there was political shenanigans going on in a certain office up on the third floor where they were trying to hire back the former community development person. And after all, she didn't get pushed out the door where she deserved to be thrown out 10 years ago. And you know, I'm not big on Machiavellian, and I know some of you people never heard of him, but he was big on cutting throats, okay? And as far as I'm concerned, if I were mayor, I'd have that particular person fired. Cut her budget as soon as you can. Now, the last thing I'm going to tell you here, Mayor, is you just being here breathing up there in that office up there is more than the last two mayors have ever done. Thank you very much for your service.
Thank you, Miles. With that, I will close the public session and call this meeting to order. Will you please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance? Pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Clerk, please call the roll.
His Honor, the Mayor.
Here.
Councillor Reynolds.
Here.
Councillor McLaughlin.
Here.
Councillor Emmons.
He's excused.
Councillor Walker.
Here.
Councilor Gozick.
Here.
Councilor Van Buren.
Here.
Councilor Corradino.
Here.
Six are present, one excused, Your Honor.
Thank you. Under the mayor's report, I'll read a proclamation for Fair Housing Month, the month of April. And as you all know, Justin Rudzik in the Community Development Office work all year round on providing fair housing within the community. So the proclamation is the 48th anniversary of passage of Fair Housing Act of 1968. Whereas the strength of our nation and all of its cities flows from the promise of individual equality and freedom of choice, and whereas the 48th anniversary of the National Fair Housing Law, Title 8 of the Civil Rights Act of 1968 during the month of April, is an occasion for all Americans individually and collectively to rededicate themselves to the principle of freedom of choice and to participate in efforts to eliminate vestiges of housing discrimination wherever they exist. This law guarantees for each citizen that critical personal element of freedom of choice, selection of the home, and whereas fair housing is the policy in Oswego, implementation of that policy requires the positive commitment, involvement, and support of each one of our citizens. Now, therefore, I, William J. Barlow, Jr., Mayor of the City of Oswego, do hereby proclaim April 2016 as Fair Housing Month in Oswego, and ask the people of the city to join in reaffirming the obligation and commitment of fair housing opportunities for all. That's all I have. Anything from any of the councilors? Seeing none, typically the state of the city is held a little earlier in the year. I put that off to combine it with my 100-day address. And I would just like to say that as we mark our first official 100 days together in office, we can all look back and be extremely proud of what we have already accomplished. For the first time in a long time, our residents are excited about our community. They are encouraged by their local government. They are paying attention and taking note of the changes and decisions we are making. And that is precisely why we have been aggressive and hard charging through the first 100 days and will maintain that pace for the foreseeable future. Let me first once again congratulate the newest members of city government, DPW Commissioner Tom Kells, City Attorney Kevin Caracoli, and City Clerk Dina Senzi-Lafon for transitioning into the roles quickly and competently, and I am extremely grateful for the work they took on and carry out on a daily basis. Also, I believe we owe a job well done to our new council leaders, President Sean Walker and Vice President Rob Corradino, as they serve in their respective roles and work together to make sure the two separate branches of city government function in unison. Also, I'd like to thank all of our council members who took office in trying times and have worked together to settle into office and passionately serve our constituents. It hasn't been an easy first few months as we took office facing a previously implemented water fee increase and certainly a tough budget on the horizon, but we rolled up our sleeves and immediately got to work doing exactly what our constituents asked us to do. I'm happy to work together with each of you, and I'm grateful to be joined by such a sincere, capable group of folks who truly want to do what is best for our community. When I decided to run for mayor, I ran because I felt the city needed a drastic change. We needed a jolt of energy, and we needed a can-do attitude. And when I won the election, I vouched to myself and to the residents of this city that I would use the same amount of energy and passion it took to win an election to represent and move our city forward, because the leadership in City Hall was stagnant for far too long. It is precisely the reason why we entered the new year with incredible momentum, and with the help of the Common Council, we have carried that momentum through the first 100 days, and we have made considerable progress in several different areas. Because of that momentum, I believe the state of the city is strong, energetic, and active, and although we certainly have some challenges ahead, I believe we have reason to be optimistic. We've already made progress on many different fronts, from creating a new city website that we will launch next week, to initiating the process of using debit and credit cards at City Hall, to taking unprecedented steps by creating a bipartisan ethics board to ensure a transparent government, to establishing worthy relationships with Senator Ritchie, Assemblyman Barkley, Congressman Kacko, and DPW Commissioner Matt Driscoll, all of who have already been extremely helpful. We've already proven that we aren't afraid to lead, make changes, and be productive. We accomplished overhauling systems and departments in city government that previously could have been considered broken. We started with creating a separate code enforcement office, delivering on a promise most of us had made. In addition, we established a permit coordinator position to facilitate and encourage growth and investment, and it has proven successful. The feedback we've already received have been positive, and we will continue to streamline and simplify the processes, enhance communication between our departments, and ensure that should somebody want to invest in our community, we encourage them to do so and assist them in completing their desired projects, offering solutions rather than setbacks. This culture change in City Hall will certainly help repair our reputation and prove to prospective investors and residents that we are indeed open for business. Our Community Development Office, led by Justin Rudzik, has experienced some changes within the department, and we are seeing the product of those changes. In our first 100 days working together, we delivered on another campaign promise and initiated and engaged in a waterfront feasibility study so we can finally begin to capitalize on our waterfront and determine how to best approach real development and investment. We also worked swiftly to avoid a grant recapture that could have cost the city $400,000 because of past noncompliance. We have already transitioned the Community Development Office into a local economic driver of our community, specializing in economic development and small business, and again, repairing a reputation and creating a culture that will surely help move our community forward. Perhaps the biggest challenge city government faces financially is the infamous consent decree. Without question, in the first 100 days, the administration has taken a head-on approach to this document, and we have taken gigantic steps to ensure that we remain on track and in compliance to avoid further penalty. On January 1st, we privatized the management of our wastewater plants. Camden Group has done an excellent job taking control of the plant, transforming the plants into facilities the city and state can be proud of. We have established a safety committee and a mission and work quality committee to improve the work being done and the culture at the wastewater plants. We have quickly embarked on several projects and repairs at the plant, like submitting plans of improvement to the DEC, to installing new equipment and repairing old equipment within budget. We've invested in tools and resources at the plant instead of outsourcing, creating a significant and immediate return on investment. And most of all, since taking office, the administration has reached out to our state and federal representatives to finally ask for financial help with the consent decree. We finally made some progress, and through talking to Senator Schumer's office, we can now apply for funding through the New York State Water Grants, which Community Development is working on as we speak. And having this opportunity is long overdue, but is welcome news to the folks in city government who have worked on this project for years. Finally, of all the improvements we have made and of all the successes in our first 100 days, of all the things I just mentioned, still the most complimented department and the most improved department is our Department of Public Works. The feedback I have received from the public on the visible and undeniable difference we've all seen in our parks and streets has been relentlessly positive. The culture, attitude, and morale at the DPW among the employees is at an all-time high, and we can see it in the work they do and in the results they are producing. This administration is serious about responding to our constituents, and we have made an honest effort and substantial progress in responding quickly and providing them with the most basic services that they not only expect, but deserve. The department is much more visible, spending significantly more time in our parks, neighborhoods, and downtown. And again, we will continue to work on customer service. Customer service for our taxpayers is the top priority of the DPW and this administration citywide, and being friendly, being responsive, being helpful to the general public is our most sought-after goal, and the progress we have made and will continue to make within the DPW is exceptional. The DPW is essentially the backbone of city services, and I couldn't be more proud of how far we have come from the top down in that department, and I owe much of that to the new commissioner, the supervisors, and every single employee at the garage. Now, despite our many quick victories and our undeniable progress, some folks probably still question if we will succeed or if we can keep up this pace. But I took office eager to get things done and make changes and move forward, knowing that not everyone will agree with me or us all the time. When you make significant changes and deviate from the quote-unquote way we've always done it, and you look at things from an unorthodox or different point of view, people are going to question you, and they'll be loud, and they'll be passionate, and it'll be quite heated and controversial at times. When you take down the fence around City Hall or you propose a new parking policy, not everyone might always agree with that. But I refuse to be the mayor or be an administration that plays it safe and watches everyone else do all the work and wait for a solution to arrive and worry about the next election. More importantly, we have too much opportunity in front of us that we cannot let slip away. Moving forward, we will be focused on continuing to enhance our code enforcement program to help revitalize our neighborhoods. We will continue to instill the mentality that city government is here to encourage investment in residential and commercial property. We can solve the problems for our constituents, not create them. We will emphasize customer service and be user-friendly and streamline processes and be consistent in enforcement and compliance. We will continue to forge relationships with our state and federal representatives and agencies so we can continue to make progress on the daunting consent decree that will certainly continue to be our biggest challenge moving forward. We will present a plan to help recover and rebuild our city's infrastructure and neglected buildings and equipment. We will look for and consider reforming and restructuring fees with the intent to ease the burden on our taxpaying homeowners. We must make a serious attempt to capture the available downtown revitalization initiative funding from Governor Cuomo that was passed in the state budget and focus on developing our waterfront and utilizing our natural resources. We've made a commitment to our homeowners to restructure city water rates in order to provide relief. And soon, I'll be rolling out a long-term capital budget plan to the Common Council so for the first time in years, the city can forecast and plan the large projects and purchases we need to get done. So there is still plenty of work to do. We know that this year's budget will be difficult, and that is why we must keep this momentum and continue to exude the same amount of leadership that we already have in the first 100 days. There isn't a group of people I'd rather be working with to accomplish our goals. We have such a capable, competent, we have such capable, competent department heads that I know will face the challenges ahead with strength and determination, and I am certain that we will overcome any adversity. I'm thankful again to have such a sincere and hardworking Common Council, and I can't begin to put into words how honored I am to serve the residents of this great community. We are 100 days in and have already accomplished a lot, and we must keep working hard. I, for one, cannot wait to get to City Hall every day to serve this community, and I look forward to what I know we will accomplish together for the city of Oswego. Thank you, and thank you to the public whom we proudly serve. Clerk, please call Resolution 116.
To approve the minutes from the Common Council meeting held March 28, 2016.
Councilor Gozick, Councilor Walker. Any comments? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Yes.
Councilor Walker.
Yes.
Councilor Gozick.
Yes.
Councilor Van Buren.
Yes.
Councilor Cordino.
Yes.
Councilor Reynolds.
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Clerk, please call Resolution 117.
To appoint Commissioner of Deeds.
Councilor McLaughlin, Councilor Van Buren. Any comments? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Yes.
Councilor Walker.
Yes.
Councilor Gozick.
Yes.
Councilor Van Buren.
Yes.
Councilor Cordino.
Yes.
Councilor Reynolds.
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Clerk, please call Resolution 118.
To approve the use of public space, the Oswego YMCA, owner of property located at 265 West First Street, in order to use and maintain three banner poles.
Councilor Gozick, Councilor Corradino. Any comments? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Yes.
Councilor Walker.
Yes.
Councilor Gozick.
Yes.
Councilor Van Buren.
Yes.
Councilor Cordino.
Yes.
Councilor Reynolds.
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Clerk, please call Resolution 119.
To approve the use of public space, Ann Backer, owner of Taste the World at Canal Commons, in order to host the Mugs and Motors Car Social on West First Street on Sunday afternoons.
Councilor McLaughlin, Councilor Van Buren. Mercedes brought up a good point in trying to find solutions to some problems. Obviously, some problems sometimes extend beyond the mayor and the Common Council when you involve unions and contracts and everything else that goes along with running a city. And we worked together. Jody Del Bracco was here. He's the president of the SEIU union. And it takes teamwork from people like Jody, people like Commissioner Kells, to make agreements and to work things out. And together they worked out the problem that was the debate last week. So I personally support approving this event, and I believe we can do it without creating additional overtime. Any comments from councilors? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Yes.
Councilor Walker.
Yes.
Councilor Gozick.
Yes.
Councilor Van Buren.
Yes.
Councilor Cordino.
Yes.
Councilor Reynolds.
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Clerk, please call Resolution 120.
To approve the use of the Crisafulli Rink by the Port City Roller Derby organization for the 2016 season.
Councillor McLaughlin, Councillor Gozick. Any comments? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councillor McLaughlin.
Yes.
Councillor Walker.
Yes.
Councillor Gozick.
Yes.
Councillor Van Buren.
Yes.
Councillor Cordino.
Yes.
Councillor Reynolds.
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Clerk, please call resolution 121.
To grant permission to Kevin Hill of Shop Oswego Live Oswego to host the summer concert series to be held at Veterans Memorial Park during the summer months.
Councillor, what is this? Councillor Van Buren, Councillor Reynolds. Any comments? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councillor McLaughlin.
Yes.
Councillor Walker.
Yes.
Councillor Gozick.
Yes.
Councillor Van Buren.
Yes.
Councillor Cordino.
Yes.
Councillor Reynolds.
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Clerk, please call resolution 122.
To grant permission to Jennifer Mays of Oswego Expeditions use of the Eastside Community Garden for cleanup and maintenance.
Councillor McLaughlin, Councillor Cordino. Any comments? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councillor McLaughlin.
Yes.
Councillor Walker.
Yes.
Councillor Gozick.
Abstain.
Councillor Van Buren.
Yes.
Councillor Cordino.
Yes.
Councillor Reynolds.
Yes.
The resolution passes 5-0-2.
Clerk, please call resolution 123.
To approve the appointment of Mark Tesserario to the Board of Assessment Review.
Councillor Reynolds, Councillor Van Buren. Any comments? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councillor McLaughlin.
Yes.
Councillor Walker.
Yes.
Councillor Gozick.
Yes.
Councillor Van Buren.
Yes.
Councillor Cordino.
Yes.
Councillor Reynolds.
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Clerk, please call resolution 124.
To refer petition submitted by Anthony Pauline, owner of real property located at 111-113 West 3rd Street for a change of zone from an R3 residential district to a B2 central business district to the planning board for their advisory opinion.
Councillor Gozick, Councillor Reynolds. Any comments? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councillor McLaughlin.
Yes.
Councillor Walker.
Yes.
Councillor Gozick.
Yes.
Councillor Van Buren.
Yes.
Councillor Cordino.
Yes.
Councillor Reynolds.
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Clerk, please call resolution 125.
To authorize a public hearing regarding Verizon Wireless Telecommunications Facility at 132 Ellen Street.
Councillor Cordino, Councillor Walker. Any comments? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councillor McLaughlin.
Yes.
Councillor Walker.
Yes.
Councillor Gozick.
Yes.
Councillor Van Buren.
Yes.
Councillor Cordino.
Yes.
Councillor Reynolds.
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Clerk, please call resolution 126.
To authorize the mayor to execute agreements with the Oswego City County Youth Bureau for the 2016 operation of the Youth Center and Skateboard Park.
Councillor McLaughlin, Councillor Walker. Any comments? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councillor McLaughlin.
Yes.
Councillor Walker.
Yes.
Councillor Gozick.
Yes.
Councillor Van Buren.
Yes.
Councillor Cordino.
Yes.
Councillor Reynolds.
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Clerk, please call resolution 127.
To authorize the mayor to execute all documents necessary to apply for the FY 2016 Family Self-Sufficiency Program.
Councillor Gozick, Councillor Van Buren. Any comments? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councillor McLaughlin.
Yes.
Councillor Walker.
Yes.
Councillor Gozick.
Yes.
Councillor Van Buren.
Yes.
Councillor Cordino.
Yes.
Councillor Reynolds.
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Clerk, please call resolution 128.
To approve the transfer of funds from the contingent account to the Department of Public Works.
Councillor Walker, Councillor Cordino. Any comments? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councillor McLaughlin.
Yes.
Councillor Walker.
Yes.
Councillor Gozick.
Yes.
Councillor Van Buren.
Yes.
Councillor Cordino.
Yes.
Councillor Reynolds.
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Clerk, please call resolution 129.
To approve the transfer of funds from the contingent account to the Department of Public Works.
Councillor McLaughlin. Councillor Reynolds. Any comments? Clerk, please call the roll.
Counselor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Counselor Walker?
Yes.
Counselor Gozick?
Yes.
Counselor Van Buren?
Yes.
Counselor Cordino?
Yes.
Counselor Reynolds?
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Clerk, please call Resolution 130.
To approve the transfer of funds from the contingent account to the Department of Public Works.
Counselor Van Buren, Counselor Walker. Comments?
Just one, Mayor.
Counselor Gozick.
Yeah, I was wondering, in the future, I think this is worthy. Commissioner Cowles had made a good case last week for preserving our fleet of trucks over the DPW, but I was hoping in the future, I know Commissioner Cowles just came in. I would like to see items like this hopefully budgeted. Will these be budgeted in the future? Come from the contingent fund?
Very good, Counselor. Any other comments? Clerk, please call the roll.
Counselor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Counselor Walker?
Yes.
Counselor Gozick?
Yes.
Counselor Van Buren?
Yeah.
Counselor Cordino?
Yes.
Counselor Reynolds?
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Clerk, please call Resolution 131.
To approve the transfer of funds from the contingent account to the Department of Public Works.
Counselor Van Buren, Counselor Cordino. Any comments? Counselor Gozick.
Yeah, the concerns brought before the council earlier tonight on the spraying. I was just wondering, have we used these chemicals? Has this been common practice in the past? I just wasn't made aware. Nobody had spoke to it last week, and I wasn't aware of it. But it concerns me just because of the parks and with children, you know, and everybody, you know, nobody's thought of it, but nobody had brought attention to the chemicals being used. I thought if citizens came up made a good point. Is there anybody who can speak to this? Have we been using these same chemicals for years, or is this a new?
I think, Counselor, I don't know if we've ever used this particular chemical, but I'm sure that through the history of the city, we've used a pesticide or some sort of weed-killing spray at one time or another. I doubt that this is highly out of the ordinary between what other municipalities do or what if we've ever used any sort of spray. I highly doubt this is out of the ordinary compared to what we used back then. I mean, this stuff is licensed and certified by the state. We're not buying it off of a black market or anything like that. It's pretty routine. Any other comments? Clerk, please call the roll.
Counselor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Counselor Walker?
Yes.
Counselor Gozick?
No.
Counselor Van Buren?
Yeah.
Counselor Cordino?
Yes.
Counselor Reynolds?
Yes.
The resolution passes 5-1-1.
Clerk, please call Resolution 32.
To approve the attendance at the New York State Association of Personnel and Civil Service Officers annual conference to be held June 5th through the 8th, 2016 in Rochester, New York at the request of Rita Tickle, Personnel Director.
Counselor McLaughlin, Counselor Van Buren, any comments? Clerk, please call the roll.
Counselor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Counselor Walker?
Yes.
Counselor Gozick?
Yes.
Counselor Van Buren?
Yes.
Counselor Cordino?
Yes.
Counselor Reynolds?
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Clerk, please call Resolution 133.
To waive the rules of the Common Council to present Resolution Numbers 134 and 135 from the floor without committee consideration.
Counselor Walker, Counselor Van Buren. This relates to Route 48. I've said before we do not like to bring things to the floor without committee consideration, but this is good news and it's time sensitive, so we have to move on it. What this relates to Route 48, we've mentioned the city is responsible for maintaining that portion of State Route 48. However, we've worked incredibly well with Commissioner Matt Driscoll and the state DOT. They've been extremely helpful, and we have an opportunity to work with state DOT to gather some federal aid. We're talking up to 80% of the Route 48 project, which we estimate to be around $2 million. Up to 80% could be covered and paid for by the feds, reimbursed by the feds. Also, pending some additional approvals, hopefully we'll get word of that here soon. Of the 20% we would still be responsible for, there's a chance that the state will be willing to pay for 15% of that 20%, leaving us with roughly being responsible for about 5%. However, the bad news is this project, any work on this project, likely won't take place until 2017. In the meantime, the state DOT is still doing some of the engineering work and really gathering all the facts and relaying that information to us. So that's the bad news. But obviously, it's good news to hear that financially we won't be responsible for the whole thing, possibly. Any comments? Councilor Walker.
Yeah. I just want to thank the mayor, DPW commissioner, and community development director for reaching out to different levels of the government, state and federal, and so on, just for the help of different projects that we have going on, like 48, the consent decree. We haven't had that done in the past in a while, and we're getting some good feedback from them and a little help from the federals and the state governments. And again, thank you guys.
Thanks, Councilor. And we're waiving the rules. Resolution 134, 135 both pertain to what I just explained. Any other comments? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Yes.
Councilor Walker.
Yes.
Councilor Gozick.
Yes.
Councilor Van Buren.
Yes.
Councilor Cordino.
Yes.
Councilor Reynolds.
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Clerk, please call resolution 134.
To authorize the mayor to execute all documents necessary to effectuate an agreement with the New York State Department of Transportation for the Route 48 Emergency Slope Stabilization and Highway Repairs Project, design and construction inspection, and further apply for federal aid and or Marchiselli aid for the project.
Councilor McLaughlin, Councilor Corradino. Any comments? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Yes.
Councilor Walker.
Yes.
Councilor Gozick.
Yes.
Councilor Van Buren.
Yes.
Councilor Corradino.
Yes.
Councilor Reynolds.
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Clerk, please call resolution 135.
To authorize the mayor to execute all documents necessary to effectuate an agreement with the New York State Department of Transportation for the Route 48 Emergency Slope Stabilization and Highway Repairs Project, right-of-way work, and further apply for federal aid and or Marchiselli aid for the project.
Councilor Van Buren, Councilor Walker. Any comments? Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Yes.
Councilor Walker.
Yes.
Councilor Gozick.
Yes.
Councilor Van Buren.
Yes.
Councilor Corradino.
Yes.
Councilor Reynolds.
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Any unfinished business to come before the council?
Move to adjourn.
Seconded by Councilor McLaughlin. Clerk, please call the roll.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Yes.
Councilor Walker.
Yes.
Councilor Gozick.
Yes.
Councilor Van Buren.
Yes.
Councilor Corradino.
Yes.
Councilor Reynolds.
Yes.
The resolution passes 6-0-1.
Meeting adjourned.